Please turn with me in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. And if you are looking in your bulletin this morning, the sermon's title is not The Birth of the Savior. That was last week. I did put more effort into preparing the sermon than I did into preparing the bulletins today. So this sermon is actually on the single sufficient sacrifice of Christ. The single sufficient sacrifice of Christ. And today we'll be looking at verses 11 through 18. Hebrews 10, verses 11 through 18. And before we read, will you please join me in prayer? Father God, we are gathered here this morning, not because we're trying to earn anything from you, but because we love you. We rejoice in what you have done for us. We want to know you more. We want to serve you more faithfully. We want to trust you more completely. And Father, we ask that as we come to the end of one year and the beginning of another, that you would allow us to just set everything else aside for this time, that we might think with undivided minds on your word, that we might see more clearly the riches of Christ that have been bestowed on us. And we might love you more in the days ahead. We ask this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Hebrews 10, beginning in verse 11. Remember, the author has been writing about the rightness of Christian faith as the fulfillment of Judaism and the impossibility of returning to the Jewish faith. Specifically, in these few chapters, how the entire sacrificial system only existed up to the time of Christ, and that Christ's sacrifice was greater and better, and it is now impossible to return to the old system. Hebrews 10, beginning in verse 11. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also bears witness to us. For after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds." Then he adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more." Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. The bulk of our time this morning, we'll be looking at this single sacrifice for sins that Christ made. But before we get there, we go through verse 11, speaking of the Levitical priesthood and their sacrificial system. And every priest stands daily at his service, offering repeatedly the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. And I know we've spent a lot of time, the book of Hebrews spends a lot of time proclaiming the superiority of Christ's sacrifice over the Levitical priesthood. But we shouldn't let that blind us to how incredible the Levitical priesthood and the sacrificial system really was. Until the death of Christ, this was the greatest thing that the world had ever seen. God himself spoke to his people and gave them exact detailed instructions on what sacrifices they're to perform, how and when they were supposed to do them, exactly how everything was to work. They were performed by God's select people out from among his select people, out from among his select people. It was only one family, the family of Aaron, from one tribe, the tribe of Levi, from one people, the people of Israel, out of the entire world that could perform these sacrifices. That the sacrificial system takes up an enormous portion of the Old Testament, Exodus, Leviticus, Deuteronomy, Numbers, explaining everything about how all of this was to be performed. It's so much greater than anything that the pagan religions around them could offer, so much greater than anything that Hinduism or Buddhism or Islam can offer, so much greater than anything that just human intellect could come up with. And yet, these sacrifices can never take away sins. And if these sacrifices, which God himself had established, can never take away sins, how much less can we trust in anything that we do on our own? But so many people want to deal with their sins on their own terms. Yeah, whether it's through some other religion where, okay, I'm going to, you know, repeat this ritual saying, and I'm going to perform these ritual prayers, and I'm going to, you know, give a seventh of my income to the poor. Whether it's just, you know, I'm going to eliminate all my desires because it's desire that leads to sin and suffering. Whether it's just living a good life and being a good person. People try all these things to take away sins. If the sacrificial system could not take away sins, then surely nothing else that you can do can. Augustus Toplady wrote the song Rock of Ages in one of the verses that we don't normally sing. A lot of good verses get left out of the passage. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin could not atone. Thou must say, and thou alone. It doesn't matter how hard you work, it doesn't matter how bad you feel about your sins, none of these things can take away sins. There's no hope in your efforts of removing your sins. There's only one hope, and it's the only hope for the entire world, and that hope is Jesus Christ. Verse 12, but when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. And by a single offering, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. So we need to see four things about Christ's single sacrifice here. First is that Christ's single sacrifice finished the work of atonement. The priests stood daily at their service. They were offering repeatedly the same sacrifices, day after day, month after month, year after year. People would come bringing goats and rams and bulls and doves. They'd offer them again and again and again. The work of the Levitical priesthood never ended. But Christ, after performing this single sacrifice, sat down at the right hand of God. He sat down. He didn't need to stand anymore. He didn't need to do any more work. He didn't need to stand back up the next day. He sat down and he remains seated, waiting. The single sacrifice finished the work. Nothing else needs to be done. Not only did that single sacrifice finish the work, but that sacrifice also secured his victory. Verse 13 again, he's after his sacrifice on the cross, He's waiting from that time until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet. And while I'm confident most of us don't have any difficulty in accepting either the power of Christ's sacrifice or his ultimate victory over his foes, we might not see how they all work together. What's the connection between the sacrifice of Christ and how he can now just wait until his enemies should be made a footstool for his feet? First, we need to understand, who are the enemies of Christ? We tend to, at least I tend to, want to make this far more complicated, where you have, you know, God's people, the Christians who trust in him and believe in him and are welcomed into his kingdom. And then you've got the enemies of God, certainly Satan, and then people like Christopher Hitchens, and these just very aggressive atheists who are determined to destroy the Christian faith, and maybe some just really mean, nasty Charles Manson type people. You know, those are the enemies of God. They clearly hate everything good and godly. And then you've just got a bunch of people who are just people. And they're not God's friends. They're not God's enemies. They're just kind of there. But the reality is that because of who God is, because of what he deserves from us, Revelation 4:11. Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. God deserves worship and obedience from everyone in the world. By right, they belong to him. So everyone is either an obedient worshiper of God, or they're a rebellious sinner against God. Either they acknowledge his authority or they fight against it. Everyone is either a child of God or an enemy of God, an offspring of the woman or the seed of the serpent. Everyone stands in one of these two camps. But Christ's victory doesn't rest upon some need to increase his strength or his strategic position at any moment in history. As God's demonstrated throughout Scripture, he can wipe out the entire world with a flood. He can call fire and brimstone down upon Sodom and Gomorrah. He can consume Nadab and Abihu with fire when they displease him. He can easily, without difficulty, destroy his enemies. And as we read the book of Revelation, we see, I mean, there's battles and there's armies, but there's never any struggle on God's behalf. He just speaks and slays them with the sword that comes out of his mouth. He casts them into the lake of fire. They have no power to resist God. The difficulty, if you can call it a difficulty, facing God is what Jesus taught in the parable of the weeds. Matthew 13, verses 24 through 30. Jesus says that the parable of the weeds, Jesus says, the kingdom of God can be compared to a farmer who sowed wheat in a field. But overnight, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat. And his servants come to him and say, Master, we planted wheat, but now there's all these weeds in the field too. And the master says, you know, an enemy has done this. And the servant said, well, should we tear out all the weeds? We can get rid of the weeds. The master says, no, lest in tearing out the weeds, you damage the wheat also. rather wait, let them grow, and when the time for harvest comes, we'll gather the weeds first, throw them into the fire, and then gather the wheat into my barns. He's going to wait, again, so that all of the wheat can be protected and brought in. The difficulty of Christ in destroying his enemies, difficulty is not the right word, but I don't have a better one, is ensuring that as his enemies are destroyed, that not one of his people, not one of his children is harmed. To preserve his saints while destroying his enemies. And he saves his saints, he rescues them through the sacrifice on the cross. Because through the sacrifice, your sins have been atoned for. You're now reconciled to God. You've been brought safely out of the domain of darkness and into the kingdom of God's beloved Son. And now you are completely safe and secure from God's wrath, so that when he pours it out upon an unrighteous world, you are completely safe. You will not be harmed. If God were to judge the ungodly prior, if he were to judge the entire ungodly world prior to the sacrifice of Christ, then we, all of us, would have been destroyed also. And that is why Christ is still waiting. It's not that Christ has to accumulate some larger army, achieve a superior strategic position so that he can destroy his enemies. He's waiting for the wheat to grow and ripen. He's waiting for all of his elect to be gathered in. We don't know who those people are. We don't know how long it will take, but we can be certain that every person whom God has chosen to save will be brought to faith before the judgment comes. He will not lose one of those on whom he has placed his love, not one of those whom the Father has given to the Son. His victory is secured. All of God's elect are saved because of this single sacrifice of Christ. And it's that single sacrifice, and this flows in his victory. It's because his single sacrifice has perfected all God's saints. Verse 14, by a single sacrifice, he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. This single offering has perfected all of God's people. We're not perfected through our own efforts. We are perfected by the single offering of Christ. What does it mean to be perfected? Because at the same time he says he has perfected those who are being sanctified. And we tend to think of sanctification as the process of being made perfect. You know, sanctification is how we are cleansed from sin and conformed more and more to the image of Christ. So clearly the author means something different by speaking in the perfect tense of our perfection and the active present tense, it's passive but present tense, of being sanctified. The author actually addresses both of those points in the next three verses. First, what does it mean for us to be sanctified, to be in the process of being sanctified, verses 15 and 16. The Holy Spirit also bears witness to us, for after saying, this is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord, I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. This is our experience of being sanctified. It's what God promised in Jeremiah 31:33, which is what's being quoted here. It's this exact same promise as Ezekiel 36, verses 26 and following. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. No longer is God's law something external to us, something written on tablets of stone that we have to go look at and read and that our hearts reject and rebel against. Rather, they're written on the fabric of our being. They become a part of us. No longer are Christians bound by something external to them, something that someone tells them they have to do, that they grudgingly might go along with because they don't want to get in trouble, that they always want to toe the line against and push as far as they can before they get caught. It's no longer a question of, well, how far can I go before this becomes unacceptable? It's no longer how much can I get away with before God gets mad. We keep God's law because we love God's law. And we avoid sin because it has become hateful to us. And no longer do we ask, okay, how far can I go before I cross the line? Rather, we say, how deeply can I run into God's will? How far can I stay from sin? Not because we earn anything for ourselves by keeping the law, but because it's become part of us. It's natural to us. And this is an ongoing process in the Christian life. None of us are sinlessly perfect. If you believe you are, I encourage you to talk to your spouse. But we're in an ongoing process of, as Romans 8 says, we're putting to death the deeds of the flesh. And we're being conformed more and more to the image of Christ. The law continues to be written on our hearts. We're more set free from the power of sin. But that's not what perfects us. We're perfected because of what is written in verse 17. Jeremiah 31:34. Then he says, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. We're not perfected or completed or finished because of how far we have advanced in sanctification. When you arrive at the gates of heaven, when you stand before the judgment seat of Christ and books are opened, they're not going to look and say, Sonia, you conquered these three sins in your life and you did these four good things, and there's just one issue that kind of remains, so we'll let you in. Brandon, sorry, you only had victory over one and a half sins. You had three really big ones remaining, so you're not getting in. That's not how it's going to happen. What do they look for in the book of what? Again, Revelation 19 and 20. Is your name written in the Lamb's Book of Life? That's the criteria. Have you been perfected by Christ? He is our surety because his sacrifice has atoned for our sins. His righteousness has been given to us. So our sins are no longer remembered. Micah 7. Forgot my reference. 7:19. It's embarrassing. Micah 7:19. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. They didn't have submarines in ancient Israel. In fact, I still don't think Israel has any submarines. That doesn't matter. If something's at the bottom of the sea, it's not recoverable. anymore. They're tread underfoot. They are destroyed, crushed, put to nothing. Psalm 103, verses 11 and 12. Just verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he taken our sins from us. And you can walk east every day for the rest of your life, and you'll never be west again. You always go further east. They never touch. They're in opposite directions. The only way you can get back to west is by turning around. They're removed. They're gone forever. This doesn't mean that God actually forgets our sins. It's not that, you know, somebody mentions a past sin and God, oh, that's weird, I didn't remember that. It's that God chooses to disregard those sins and act as if they never occurred. He will no longer act upon them. He will not treat you as them. No longer treat you as guilty of them. When you get to heaven, God's not going to say, Danny, remember that day 14 years ago? You did that really, really bad thing. He's never going to bring it up. He's never going to mention it. He's never going to judge you on it. It is done and gone, put away forever. That is the perfection that you have. And it's not just some technicality. It's not a legal trick to, you know, just move things around and hide the truth. God is the creator and upholder of the universe, and he determines truth. And when he says you are clean, you are clean. And when he says you are acceptable, you are acceptable. And when he says you are holy, you are holy. And when he says you are perfect, you are perfected. There's nothing you can add to this perfection. There's nothing you can take away from it. You are perfected, made acceptable in God's sight, solely because of the work, the sacrifice of Christ. The final thing on the sacrifice of Christ is that it endures forever. The author says twice, it's for all time. Verse 12, but when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, and then he says in verse 14, for by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are being sanctified. Christ's sacrifice is for all time, both historically and personally. Historically, it doesn't matter that Christ's sacrifice was almost 2,000 years ago from where we are now. It wouldn't have mattered if we were living 2,000 years before Christ's sacrifice. It is the only sacrifice for sins. It has always been the only sacrifice for sins. It will always be the only sacrifice for sins. Everyone who has ever been saved has been saved by the sacrifice of Christ. It never loses its power. It never loses its efficiency, its effectiveness. It endures forever. And should the Lord tarry for another 10,000 years, it will still be that sacrifice on that cross that provides the way of salvation for all those who call upon his name. It is the single sacrifice for all time. But it also personally is for all time. Perfected for all time, those who are being sanctified. At the moment when you placed your faith in Christ, you were perfected by his grace through your faith. And that perfection is yours forever. After we've been in eternity for 10,000 years, or 10 million years, or eternity of eternities, we're still going to be perfected only through the work of Christ. Samuel Rutherford wrote, we sing it in the sands of time are sinking. I stand upon his merit. I know no other stand, not even where glory dwelleth in Emmanuel's land. He is our perfection. He's our only perfection. He's a sufficient perfection. We never have to worry about how perfect we can make ourselves. We never have to worry about if we're doing enough to be acceptable in God's sight. His work perfects us for all time. We'll never wear out. It'll never get worn out or washed off. We're perfected for all time. And because of that, because of the finished work that secures Christ's victory, that perfects his saints, and that endures forever, therefore, verse 18, where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. This is directly going against the Jewish system, where you sinned and you brought an offering to the priest to sacrifice on your behalf. But it also rebukes every other religious system in the world, including popular Christianity in the United States today. It rebukes Roman Catholicism, where you've sinned, and what do you need to do? You go to the priest and you confess your sins, and then he gives you penance to restore your relationship with God. It rebukes the popular Protestant Christianity, where, okay, I did something bad, so now I have to do something good to make up for it. Maybe I need to go to church more often, or read my Bible more faithfully. Maybe I need to donate more money to a good cause. Maybe I just need to avoid this sin for a certain length of time, and then I'll make up for it. I've made my offering for sin. Christ alone is our offering for sin. We need to avoid the error of trying to make an offering for our sins. This doesn't mean that we don't have any obligations or responsibilities in our Christian life. We shouldn't continue in sin that grace may abound because Christ has taken care of it all. Just keep reading through Hebrews. Hebrews 11:24, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. Verse 26 is a warning against those who go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth. Hebrews 12:14 says, strive for peace with everyone and for holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. These things are necessary for us to do, but we can't base our security on our either faithfulness or effectiveness in these things. Our security is in Christ. Everything that we do as Christians should be motivated not by a desire to earn our standing with God, not by a desire to repay what God has done for us, but just out of a glowing heart of thankfulness and praise for who He is and what He's done for us. It's not going to affect how we're received by God. George Whitefield and John Wesley were the founders and leaders of the Methodist movement in England during the First Great Awakening. Almost certainly the two greatest evangelists that England has ever seen. They started as good friends, and by the end of their lives, they were no longer speaking to each other because John Wesley was an Arminian and could not accept George Whitefield's Calvinism. But after Whitefield's death, Wesley was asked, "Do you think you'll see George Whitefield in heaven?" Their dispute over Calvinism was so fierce that a lot of people thought that they each must be convinced that the other person's not saved. And Wesley is reported to have replied that, "I don't think I'll see George Whitefield in heaven because he was such a great servant of God and shone so brightly that he'll be so close to the throne of God that I won't be able to see him from way in the back where I am." That's not right. George Whitefield was certainly the greatest evangelist England's ever seen. He preached to hundreds of thousands of people a week in England and in the American colonies. When he was on wooden boats sailing across the Atlantic Ocean back and forth, he preached to the sailors and have much bigger crowds than you've ever had in this room here. He preached in Philadelphia once to twice the population of Philadelphia. So many people came in from miles outside the city to hear him preach. None of that means anything to his acceptability before God. You can go stand on the corner here in this freezing cold weather, holding signs or passing out tracts or preaching through a megaphone, and that's a good thing to do, but it's not going to make you more acceptable in God's sight. You can pray 20 hours a day and memorize the entirety of your Bible, you can devote your body to be burned, you can endure all sorts of persecutions for Christ. None of it's going to atone for a single sin. God's not going to accept you on the basis of any of that. George Whitefield and I, though by any human measure, I'm not worthy of to unlace his shoes. I don't think he ever wore sandals. Stand before Christ in the exact same position, perfected only because of the work of Christ, acceptable only because of the work of Christ. And neither one of us, and nobody else in this room, and no one else in the history of Christianity will ever have anything to add to that before the throne of heaven besides the work of Christ on our behalf. It's really hard to wait until this evening to go to Acts 2 and start talking about this Jesus of Nazareth turned over into the hands of lawless men. It's the sacrifice of Christ that perfects us. God became flesh and dwelt among us. And He alone lived a perfect, sinless human life, complete obedience to the Father. He healed the sick, cast out demons, He fed the hungry, and He preached good news. And the world responded by arresting Him and hating Him, crucifying Him. But even though this was done by the hands of lawless men, it was done according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. Because while Christ was crucified, our sins, the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands, was nailed to the cross. And God the Son bore the wrath of God the Father against sin for all those who would believe in Him. Trust in that work. Trust in that sacrifice. Trust that we're telling the truth when we sing, Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Don't work to earn anything from God. Don't trust in anything about yourself. Trust in the work of Christ. It is our only hope. It's your only hope. Let's pray. Father, we believe that Your love is far greater than tongue or pen can ever tell. Lord, the sacrifice of Your Son is so much greater than I've expressed. The security that He has bought us is so much stronger. The love that You've displayed for us is so much deeper. Lord, we pray that You would be pleased to take these efforts in Your word and by the miraculous work of the Holy Spirit, plant the reality of these things within our hearts, that we might know and feel them to be true. That we would live our lives not trusting in ourselves, but in the work of Your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.